morning, everybody. How's everybody doing? Good morning. Good morning, everybody. Thank you. We have a lot more energy than that here at SB, you guys. Come on now. I know it's early. Well, listen, I just wanted to say hello real quick. My name is Misti Turnbull. I'm the news director here at Channel 2, and we are just delighted to have you. And you know, I know this is a good meeting for you all, and you get a lot of ideas out on the table, and I just wanted to say hello. I wanted to say how happy we are that you're here. And you know, when I was approached by Sean and Tom and asked if you guys could come this morning, I was absolutely thrilled to say yes. I'm excited about your panel. I'm very excited that Lori's on the panel today. So that's great. If you have any questions later today, I'm going to be floating around. I'm happy to answer them. There will be tours later if you're interested. A few of you might not be allowed, but that's okay. We love you. We still love you, right?
Right.
I will encourage you when you go into the new set and that you see it, take pictures, take selfies, have fun with it. We're definitely open to all of that. I think there's a hashtag, right? Am I correct about that, Tom? Right? GFAF16. Right? I know you guys are tweeting like crazy out there, I see. So again, just welcome to WSB Television. I hope you guys have a great morning. Enjoy your time here. I hope the food is good. And again, we're just very appreciative and happy that you're here. Thanks. Hollie, come on up.
Thanks, WSB, for your welcome. Appreciate it. Most of you know I'm Hollie Manheimer. I'm the director of the Georgia First Amendment Foundation. For those of you who don't know what we do, we are a 22-year-old nonprofit that has really devoted ourselves over the years to promoting good government, open meetings. And it's something that every member of the board of directors, many of whom are here, is committed to, and I thank you all. We wanted to put together this panel just to talk about some of the issues this year at the Gold Dome. Some of our speakers are going to talk to you about what has happened in prior sessions at the legislature, and we will get into in depth some of the key issues and why we think they're important and what we'd like you to do in terms of helping us move the state towards better open meetings and open records laws. One of the things I want to bring to your attention for many of you sitting here is we are in transition at GFAF, Georgia First Amendment Foundation. We are turning towards a membership organization. When you came in today or at the tables, there is information about membership, and we'd like you to consider it. Lots of the board of directors is here. They can talk to you about some of the details, but please keep that in mind as we go forward today and ask me or anybody else around any of these questions. I think, and we think, we're going to have a lot of questions from the audience. We're going to walk through, each of the panelists is going to talk a little bit about their area of expertise after I introduce them. I'm going to ask them to ask some of each other some questions, and then we're going to open it up to all of you, because you're the most important people here, and ask you what you want to know, and maybe have suggestions from you all as to what to do better this year at the Capitol. We'll play it by ear in terms of whether or not we want you to hand in questions by index cards, or simply we'll just call from the audience. But with that, we don't necessarily want to hear from me. I want to give a brief overview or a bio of each of the panelists, and if you'll indulge me, I'm going to read. I've worked with all of these people for 20 years, which scares me in terms of that, but I'm always fascinated by what they're doing. So let me read to you quickly. I'm going to start to my immediate right. WSB reporter Lori Geary covers Georgia politics from the Gold Dome, as most of you all know, and thank you for your hospitality in having us here. She's reported from national political conventions and even from China, Dubai, and Cuba, where she traveled to cover state economic development efforts. Lori's work has been recognized by the Society of Professional Journalists and the Georgia Associated Press. She has won 2 Emmys here at WSB. The Washington Post recently named Lori as one of the best state political reporters in the country. To her immediate right is one of my favorite board members, although all three of the people to my right are some of my three favorite board members and mentors. Taught me just about everything I know about the First Amendment. Tom Clyde's a partner at Kilpatrick, Stockton, focuses his practice on complex commercial and appellate matters with an emphasis on representing print, television, internet, and communications companies. He's represented clients in an array of litigation in federal and state courts and frequently defends clients in lawsuits challenging First Amendment protected speech. Cynthia Counts, one of my dear friends, is, and my, again, one of my favorite board members. I don't know. Every board member in the room are all my favorites, but regardless. Cynthia is a partner at Duane Morris, defends individuals, newspapers, websites, television stations, and small businesses in libel, copyright, and trade infringement claims, as well as breach of contract, invasion of privacy, fraud, and promissory estoppel cases. She is at the forefront of the quest for broad application of Georgia's anti-SLAPP statute enacted in 1996 to provide an early mechanism for the dismissal of harassing libel litigation. And lastly, to the right, last but perhaps best, certainly among the best, is Peter Canfield, a partner at Jones Day, one of the founding board members of the First Amendment Foundation. Thank you. Recognized First Amendment authority who regularly represents media and non-media clients in defending claims for libel and invasion of privacy, compelling access to government information, protecting anonymous sources or other sensitive information, and safeguarding distribution and intellectual property rights. All right, you know it's an esteemed panel, we know that, so I'm gonna let's get to the meat of it. I wanna start with Lori today, if you'll lead us off, and give us a broad overview, if you would, of what's happening this year at Georgia's General Assembly under the Gold Dome. And for those here, everybody's interested in transparency, but what does it mean down at the Capitol, what's happening there? If you'll give us an overview, we'll take it from there.
Sure. Welcome, everyone. Make sure is the mic working? It's great to have you all here, and I'm excited to be on the panel. Tom Clyde called and left me a message yesterday. He said, okay, you have about 5 minutes. I'm like, the political reporter covering the Capitol on transparency in Georgia gets 5 minutes? So I'm going to take it really quickly if I can. But I wanted to start out with two just egregious examples of what we encountered, and probably some of you, because I know there are some journalists in the room. I was writing out my examples, and gosh, they're all the state Senate. And the state House has its own issues, but the Senate seems to make up a lot of rules that are not conducive to journalists. So I know you all remember the Don Balfour case, where he was accused of per diems and travel expenses when he was out of town. And he went before the Senate Ethics Committee, not the Ethics Commission. Now, we're talking about the Senate Ethics Committee. And we obviously wanted to follow what was happening with the case. So we sat in the committee hearing, and the senators who were on the panel said, now everybody who is not a senator can leave. And so we politely left. And then it went a little bit further because there was a window on the door. And we started shooting through the window. They started putting tape up on the windows. You know, this is in the Georgia Capitol. To me, no meeting should be closed in the Georgia Capitol. Then the troopers came. So we had armed guards outside of a door, taped paper over the windows, at a hearing at the Georgia State Capitol. And I'm thinking, are we in China? Are we in Cuba? So we weren't able to get in there. I mean, obviously we were able to get some of the information afterwards, but it just goes to show you the power that they feel that they have, that they can close out the press in a public building. Second one, has anybody ever heard of the Senate Committee on Administrative Affairs? Yeah, I didn't either. This is a committee that meets in secret. What they discuss is always private, and I got tipped off to the fact that there was a discrimination complaint against two state senators. So we went to try to get into the meeting. We couldn't even find out where the meeting was. And what had happened was they'd settled, and it was your tax dollars, so it was $80,000. Not a lot in the whole scheme of a $20 million budget, but it was the principle of the matter, that it was your tax dollars. The way we got around it, Richard Beltran kind of worked around, was we found out that Buckley and Klein was the lawyer for the woman involved. And we went to the Department of Administrative Services and got a check written out to Buckley and Klein on that particular day and found out it was for $80,000. So we kind of did it a back way. But again, it's a Senate Ethics Committee, and they meet in secret. They make their rules are even in secret. I mean, the Senate likes to make up their own rules. Two current pieces of legislation that I'm watching, it's kind of inside baseball, so it's not necessarily what I would report to the masses, but Senator Josh McCune has two pieces that we're keeping an eye on. Again, it's kind of egregious when you think about it, but when senators vote on amendments on the Senate floor, there's no recording of them. They call for hand raising. So it's like they count them, one, two, three, four, so if you want to find out what a senator did on an amendment, how they voted, you would have to physically be in that room watching your senator either raise their hand for a yay or a nay. Senator Josh McCune is trying to change that by saying that it has to be a recorded vote. And also, we know where the conference committees, that's where they get all of the work done at the last minute. So they're negotiating last minute deals. A lot of times you can't find out where the conference committees are meeting. You can't find out who's on the conference committee sometimes. And the only way sometimes I get tipped off is if one of the lawmakers says, hey, we're meeting here. And they can't really shut you out of a conference committee meeting. But if they don't tell you where it is and you can't find it, it's kind of hard to cover. So he's got legislation, Senator Josh McCune, that would open those up, that they would post where they are, and that they would actually lay on the table for like a day so that they're not voting on them in the last 2 hours of the session. Open records, I'm going to touch on real quickly. This has become a really difficult issue all of a sudden, and I'm glad Sam Owens is in the audience. I talked to a lot of reporters. I kind of took a tally in our newsroom, like, what are some of the more egregious prices on these open records requests that you're getting? And it was in the hundreds and sometimes thousands of dollars. And so when we requested, this was a few years ago, I would request a DFACS case, an overview. It was maybe a couple hundred bucks. Well, our last one was $600. And then before then, it was thousands of dollars. And we feel like it's a way for them to get around the fact that they know we can't really pay unless we all come together and pay the thousands of dollars to get around, you know, opening these cases of dead children and what happened. But the worst one, and Richard Belcher sits right next to me, and that's always fun because you can hear him yelling into the phone sometimes. That's entertainment for a reporter. It's Atlanta City Hall. I don't know how many of you have requested records from Atlanta City Hall. And it's fun. They ignore them. Yes. They don't think that they have to follow the law, right? Everybody in here is shaking their heads. And if they ignore them, they think that will go away. Or if they wait a few weeks, they would go away. Well, we don't. I mean, you guys get 3 days. They get 3 days to respond, whether it's okay, we're working on that, or they don't even respond. So. And I know Sam's time is precious and his dollars are precious, but it would be great even if there was some type of hotline in the AG's office, because I know you've worked in cases and won for open records, where we could say, hey, look, we're not getting these records. Could anybody from the AG's office call over instead of getting, I mean, we're lucky because WSB has some powerful attorneys who can fight our fight, but what about Valdosta Papers and some of the smaller towns that don't have, you know, the corporate lawyer backing that we do? So that is just one suggestion. It would be great if we had just, you know, where we didn't have to go to you directly or bug you directly, but some of your folks maybe in the office.
Thanks, Lori. And I would point out that one of the things mostly that the First Amendment Foundation gets called at on are too expensive open. I mean, every third or fifth call of mine is, it costs too much. But regardless, we'll come back to that. Peter, if you would you talk to us, assuming I can get the video working, do you think that the General Assembly this year is going to weigh in on the development of drones for commercial and news gathering purposes?
Sure. Thanks, Hollie, and thanks for being here. I thought if it's possible that one way to introduce this subject might be to give you an example, which we have here, of some of the news work that's being done with drones. We've got two leaders in this technology in the news area in Atlanta. CNN has done a great deal of work with drones. It's worked with Lockheed. It's a pathfinder under the FAA's program. WSB has gotten exemptions for drones from the FAA, and this is an example of some CNN footage of the South Carolina floods last fall, just about a minute long. Thank you. That's it. Thanks. You can just pull the plug on that. So the General Assembly does appear to be poised to weigh in on the use of drones in Georgia this year. There were a few bills introduced last year that didn't go anywhere. But the House set up a study committee, and that committee held a series of meetings last fall, and it's resulted in a bill that was introduced earlier this month by the subcommittee and its chair, Kevin Tanner, a representative from Dawsonville. It's House Bill 779. That bill is in the process of being tweaked, but I'm told the general sense is that it does stand a significant chance of getting passed. Probably not in its present form, but in some new iteration we've not yet seen. The bill's not so much aimed at where you can fly a drone. That's a federal airspace issue that's governed by federal law. And Representative Tanner told me that he made a very conscious effort to avoid any conflict with that and has worked with the FAA to come up with a bill that he thinks they basically have signed off on. So it's not a bill that's going to have the kind of no-fly zones that we got from the Georgia Building Authority that they tried to impose last year around, like, they came out with a rule that said you can't have a drone within 5 miles of the state capitol. This bill doesn't try to do anything like that. What it focuses on instead is what's much more of a traditional state law issue, which is what you can do with the drone. So here's what this bill provides, and it provides kind of an odd set of things. First, you can't use them to hunt. You also can't use them to interfere with or harass hunters. You can't.
The hunters take care.
Right. You can't weaponize them, so it would be a crime in Georgia to put a weapon on your drone. You can't use them to obstruct law enforcement or emergency medical work. So it has those kind of provisions. More important for what we want to talk about this morning, it would also regulate what sort of images, and it's not just photos, but it's also what else you can capture with a drone, which is sound. There's a lot of security concerns about what sort of, you know, if you get a drone into somebody's Wi-Fi, private Wi-Fi, if you can invade their privacy in that way. So it regulates what sort of images and data you can collect on a drone and what you can do with that data. Much of the bill is directed at things that I don't think raise issues for the media or for private citizens, and they're really more of a libertarian bent. The bill tries to restrict, has a number of provisions restricting what law enforcement can do with drones. When they have to get search warrants if they want to use a drone to conduct surveillance. And it also regulates what sort of drone imaging can be done by other government entities and by quasi-governmental entities like, utilities like the Southern Company, when they can use drones and how to control their lines throughout the state. What's relevant for First Amendment purposes, though, is that it also regulates what drone imaging can be done by private citizens and by the news media. So what does it do in that area? First, it doesn't, the way I read it as it's written now, it doesn't seem to limit taking images with drones of public property. So that seems to be generally not regulated by this bill. But what it does substantially regulate is the images you can take of private property or individuals on private property with drones, other than private property that you yourself control. So the general basic provision in the bill, and again, I think this is likely to change, but the way it's written now, it says that without permission from that private property owner or the person who has control of that private property, taking any image with a drone of that property or an individual on it would be a crime under this bill.
Even from a public place?
Even from a public place. So even if the drone is on above the street, or even if the drone is above your own property, if you are taking an image of private property that you don't own or you don't have permission to take drone images of, this would make it a crime. So to give you some examples, well, under current law, that's not the current law. You can take pictures from public property, from your own property, as long as there's no reasonable expectation of privacy by the person you're taking the picture of. And generally, there's no reasonable expectation of privacy if you can take an ordinary non-magnified photo from a place where you have a right to be. There's also a general recognition in current law that if something is going on property that you don't own and that might ordinarily have a reasonable expectation of privacy, if there's something going on there that's a matter of legitimate public concern, you can take a photo of it and not violate any law. So this bill, by changing that and making just sort of a per se prohibition unless you have permission, would be a significant change. So here's a kind of frivolous example, but let's say my neighbor is holding a Klan rally in his yard. I can stand on the street with a regular camera and take a picture of that. But if I have a drone I'm operating that's in that same place, even if it's not using some magnified image or anything of that sort, under this bill, that would be a crime to do that. Plus, and here's a further unusual provision of this bill, it's not just a crime to take that image, it's also a crime to knowingly possess or distribute any image that was taken in violation of the law. So for example, if I photographed the Klan rally with a drone on my property, you know, without any magnification, and emailed that video to CNN and said, you know, you should use this, it'd be a crime for CNN to broadcast it if they knew it was taken in violation of the statute. And it would even be a violation for CNN to possess that video if they knew it was taken in violation of the statute. So those are obvious problems that the bill has. I think Representative Tanner understands that those are problems. And there are folks with the movie industry, with CNN and others, who are working with Representative Tanner to kind of try to come up with language that would address those problems. You know, there may even be new language within a week or so, but we'll just have to stay tuned to see what happens. I would say that there is a lot of pressure on all sides to try and come up with a solution. First, there are some areas of the bill that are clearly that don't have anything to do with this media, private citizen, First Amendment issue that I think go in favor of doing something, the law enforcement regulation, for example. There's also a lot of pressure to come up with something that's statewide, like this bill, because what's happening is various municipalities are trying to come up with their own drone rules. That makes it more difficult. I think there's a sense, the study committee certainly had a sense that drones, they don't dislike drones, they actually like drones. They think it's actually a great business for Georgia to be in with all the aviation business that Georgia has now. So drones are seen as a good thing. There's a sense that they would like to create a model statute that might even be useful elsewhere in the country. So I think there's, you know, people are working to see if they can come up with something, whether they can do it, and whether they can do it in time to have something done this year, I think is a substantial question. One last issue yeah. with that is that it also raises some open records issues in the sense that there's a presumption in this throughout this bill that if images were taken in violation of its restrictions and law enforcement has them or anybody has them, they should be destroyed. So I think the sense is if law enforcement has taken some of those and you make a request for it, you know, I think the bill's authors think, well, that shouldn't be an issue because law enforcement should be, they're under command to destroy those records.
All right, thanks. And I would point out that Bob Houghton from the Georgia Association of Broadcasters is here as well. And I know his organization is obviously very interested in working with us and others on this bill. But let me turn to another issue that is also critical at the legislature. And Cynthia is going to address it. If you would explain to some of the folks who don't even know what is anti-SLAPP legislation or what SLAPP means, and then talk about what's happening in terms of at the legislature in terms of moving forward or backwards in connection with this issue.
Okay, so the anti-SLAPP, strategic litigation against public participation, it's a law that's really important that does protect us against frivolous litigation. And, you know, we've worked aggressively to make sure that the kind of speech that's at the heart of the First Amendment, which is kind of really speech about government action or people that have potential wrongdoing, all of that is going to be, sorry, stuff that, you know, the news covers routinely. But Georgia's is not as broad as, say, California. So this legislation that they're trying to bring in is what California's statute would say. To give you a sense, though, it's not as doomsday as some people think in terms of what our existing statute is. We've been very successful in Fox, and Peter's actually helped us recently in a case, too, an amicus brief, to get the extension as broad as the law says it should be. If you look at the cases, they say this statute is to be broadly construed. So what it is there is an act, and it says a matter of public concern. So initially people thought, well, any matter of public concern would be covered. That's pretty much how it is in California, and that's what we would like to move to. But just so it's very clear, existing law is that if it is an act to or before or in connection with any executive, legislative, or judicial proceeding, and that has been expansively defined, it includes trying to raise awareness. So obviously that's what the news media does, and even entertainment does, to raise awareness about these issues that are at the heart of self-government, really, right? That's the New York Times versus Sullivan. When you're talking about government action, government investigations, government proceedings, so the police, when you're investigating something. So the new statute, though, the new bill that they're proposing, I think they proposed it last year as well, would go more to the California model. I think Tom has expressed some concern, and I agree with him. One of the wonderful things about Georgia's statute is it has a verification department, whereas somebody has to file an affidavit swearing that this is being brought in good faith and that it is not a suit against public participation, is basically what it is. It's certifying that you know that you are going to be in compliance with the law. And if you don't file that within 10 days, the case goes. Now, when you're talking about litigation, frivolous or not, it is extremely expensive to defend against. And whether you're a big corporate, you know, media company or not, that's still hard. And so when somebody brings a lawsuit and they fail to do that minimum requirement, then that is a way that you can just have the case dismissed. It's not draconian, but it's one of the few statutes in Georgia that has that kind of immediate, you can't cure the defect. So it's been very successful in helping protect us against frivolous litigation. And it's a catch-22 for plaintiff's lawyers, because if they bring a suit and they bring that affidavit and it turns out that that's a false affidavit, that you are not in compliance with the basic requirements of the law in terms of what would be a legitimate libel claim, then you have to pay attorney fees, and it says you shall pay attorney's fees. So I do want to thank, you know, WSB-TV and the First Amendment Foundation for bringing us all together, because one of the things that is really important is that we work collectively, because we have similar interests, I mean, identical interests, really, in making sure that we are working together to get the legislature the information they need. They don't necessarily know all the subtleties. They don't know the issues, the concerns, and we can help educate them as a group. And that's really the purpose of the Georgia First Amendment Foundation. And so this new legislation, why would we support it? I think if we can make sure that we keep the protections we have, that's great. But it does go broader, because it does say any matter of public concern. So right now people say, oh, this statute already applies to that. No, it doesn't. It has to be about an executive, legislative, or judicial proceeding. And either one has to be pending, or one must result as a result of the petitioning speech. Jerry Weber is famous for having started the, you know, the breadth of it, because there was a case involving Harkins. It was an animal shelter case, where somebody had spoken on television and had promoted and raised awareness. And that's the first application where we've used it to say it applies to the media, no doubt it applies to the media, if it falls within the alternative definition of, you know, either to or before or in connection with, which is very broad. That's a Metz case that gives us that. But so the new statute, even if it's not in connection with or to or before an executive, legislative, or judicial proceeding, but rather a matter of significant public concern. And you can imagine the movie industry, the entertainment industry, has lots of, you know, things that they put out, documentaries, that just don't relate to something that is necessarily going to be a proceeding, a government proceeding. But it's still the speech that's at the heart of the First Amendment. So I think we're in favor of that, as long as we can get it through in a way that still protects the verification requirement, if we could. Why wouldn't we be in favor of that? We're concerned. I think the trial lawyers, Peter, association that always wants to sabotage that, I guess they're fighting against it, so we don't know if it'll make it out of committee. And you're always worried about how it's going to go through committee. But it's a great thing to expand protection for free speech if you can, because frivolous litigation is just so tremendously expensive.
Thanks. Two comments, and then I want to turn to Tom. Jerry, I was going to point out Jerry worked on this case.
So did Hollie.
Well, it's not, but I remember Jerry saying, Hollie, find something in front of the Fulton County Commission that had to do with this. And I'm like, I can't. I've been reading Fulton County Commission minutes for years trying to find a governmental proceeding from which this issue, and I couldn't find one. So anyway, that was a hitch for us. The other thing I would point out before we go on to Tom is, you know, you see the trial lawyers are against this, and I was there that time when I saw the trial lawyers say this anti-SLAPP bill needs to go. If we do work together, we can get it right, but that's the problem. Still, everybody is too disparate. So, regardless. All right, Tom, last speaker, and then everybody can, of course, ask questions. Talk to us, if you will, about another big issue, or maybe a big issue, Governor's criminal justice reform legislation and the implications on the public's right to know.
Sure, absolutely. So essentially we are in the fifth year of the Governor's criminal justice reform programs. Over the last 5 years, he's introduced legislation that has dramatically changed the way the state of Georgia incarcerates criminals, the terms that apply. And really the effort, and it's been a very successful effort, has been to try and reduce the size of Georgia's prison population and to try and make the prison system a little fairer and more effective at reintroducing offenders back into society. It's been a terrific success. It's been an example to the nation at the federal level. They're looking at Georgia and really holding it out as something that's performed very well. And so Governor Deal and the Criminal Justice Reform Council deserves a lot of credit for that. But there is one aspect of their program that has a great deal of friction with First Amendment interests. And this year, they are saying that they will be dropping new legislation. They have not dropped it yet, but it's expected, I would expect it within the next 10 to 15 days. And that the contents of that legislation they haven't disclosed, but they have suggested, and we'll have to wait and see, that one aspect of it may be trying to change the existing First Offender Act in the state of Georgia. The First Offender Act is a law that has existed in our state for some time, and it's an unusual law. It allows somebody who's before the criminal justice system on their first offense to enter a very unusual plea. In that plea, you plead under the First Offender Act, and you are placed on probation before there is an adjudication of guilt. And if you successfully complete that probation, then the criminal charges against you are discharged. What does that mean? That means you are in a position at the end of that probationary period to say, I have never been convicted of a crime. There will be no record that you were convicted of a crime. You can answer inquiries saying, I was never convicted of a crime. And so that the First Offender Act goal is basically to try and help people who are in front of the criminal justice system for the first time to make sure that they don't end up with something that permanently damages their record, a very worthwhile goal. The friction is this. There is a concern by the Criminal Justice Reform Council that notwithstanding the First Offender Act, the fact that people have been arrested, the fact that they have a criminal case file in court, is creating an impediment to their getting jobs. And so there is at least discussion that the First Offender Act should be changed so that as soon as you plead, you enter a First Offender Act plea, your case would be sealed, and your case would be sealed at the GCIC level, in other words, the database of arrest and conviction information. It would be sealed in the courtroom. It would be sealed at the courthouse itself. And that is a dramatic change from the way the law works right now. Currently, while you're on probation, your criminal case file will remain open to the public. The public can be at the case proceedings. The public can pull up your case file. And the media can as well. If this is the legislation they're proposing, it would mean as soon as you enter that plea, your case would disappear. It would disappear from the criminal justice system. It is possible the legislation they propose will not be that radical, but we have to wait and see. And so this is really an effort to try and alert people to something that may be coming. So let me just give you an example to explain sort of worst case, what are the implications of this situation in terms of access to our court system and our court records. Here's two examples. Let's say your child is injured in an assault, whether it's at school, whether it's at some public event. You want to go check on how, and the individual who assaulted him is arrested. You want to go check on how that case is proceeding. If a First Offender Act plea were allowed to be entered immediately and immediately sealed the record, when you went to the court to try and find out how that criminal case was proceeding, you would no longer be able to see the court file. The court system would say, we have no case on that. And so as soon as that person entered a First Offender Act plea, that essentially the criminal case file and all records of that criminal case would no longer be available. Give you another example from the media perspective. A candidate for city council for some public office, you're hearing from a source that he had a DUI. You want to go find that, take a look at the circumstances of that DUI. You go to the courthouse, you ask for the case file, you're told we have no case under that name. And if that council person or candidate had entered a plea under the First Offender Act, and if it's immediately sealed and sealed at all levels, the court system would not disclose that a case exists, and the court system would not allow you to see the case file, even if that's the candidate is still in their probationary period.
Wouldn't the plea still be public record?
Essentially what the Criminal Justice Reform Council has done in the way they've been changing the law, and this occurred in 2014 with in some other areas, but I think we should be focused on the legislation this year for exactly that reason, is they are also sealing law enforcement records. So when they are now the sealing program that takes place, and frequently they call it expungement, but it's essentially a sealing system. Not only are the court records sealed, but all the records at the law enforcement agency are simultaneously sealed. And so it is essentially a significant effort to erase completely the criminal history with respect to some offenses. And a lot of the focus so far has been arrests that haven't resulted in a conviction. If they move into the First Offender Act, we're going to start seeing that same system moved into arrests that resulted in a plea. A plea entered the First Offender Act in which you're really not denying liability. It's possible that this, when the legislation gets submitted, will only apply to minor nonviolent crimes. That would be a significant positive step.
How is the law written now? Is it felonies, misdemeanors?
It can apply to all levels except the seven deadly sins. Except for the most extreme crimes, you can enter a First Offender Act plea currently, but you would be put on a probation period. The more serious the crime, your probation is going to be longer, and the record of that case will be public. So, I put it out there mostly as it's something that we all need to watch, because it will potentially be a significant step to close records both at the law enforcement level and at the court system.
Thanks, Tom. And let me ask, I'm going to ask everybody who wants to pose a question. I would point out that this is all we know about right now with the legislature. For most of you know, session in Georgia goes through the end of March, so there may be other stuff out there that we don't know about yet, so let's all be vigilant and see what is next in connection with First Amendment stuff. But let's open this up to questions and take advantage of the great knowledge pool of this panel. Go ahead, sir.
Maury, you talk about the state senate. They've had closed door meetings for years, even when I was down there, but did you protest it? Did you raise hell?
Yes, we did, and I mean, we publicly did that story several times with the tape windows and ran that video over and over again. But, you know, there's a feeling there that somewhere along the lines they forgot they're for the people. You know, some of them get it, but some of them just forget that, you know, we were elected by the people, you know, and they have, you know, kind of their own club. It's kind of the feeling that we get.
Sean.
So in other states, Lori, is the legislature, so our legislature is not subject to open records and open meetings. In other states, is that the case?
That's probably for you.
Well,
I got in North Carolina, but it was like 20 years ago.
Sean's definitely right that our legislature is not subject to the Open Records Act and Open Meetings Act. They basically exempted themselves from that, so they get to pass their own rules to decide what's open and closed. And as you have eloquently explained, they frequently just close stuff almost on a whimsical basis.
Because
so,
they can.
Right.
Do other states?
It actually varies a fair amount whether other states subject their legislature to the Open Records Act, but almost every state allows the legislature itself to decide the rules of the operations of the legislature. So,
and I will add that even though Governor Neal is exempt, you can get open records from the governor's office. And we don't want to ask him, do you realize you're not? You don't have to do this because we're afraid that he'll say, oh, I didn't know. But I mean, you can get, if you do an open records request to the governor's office, you can get emails, you can get documents. They're a little bit more open. State Senate and the House. Last time I checked, we haven't done a lot with David Ralston in terms of open records, but under Glenn Richardson, no way, no how, couldn't get travel logs or anything.
Other questions? Go ahead, sir.
Peter, of course, this is about the drones and just what you think the prospects are on, because I would see putting an end to that proposed legislation. As far as the restrictive nature of it, where would you maybe see it going?
I think it's going to change a lot from what it is now. So I think the sponsors recognize that if something newsworthy is happening, something of legitimate public interest, you know, for example, that flooding video, then certainly the media should be able to photograph that and display it and get citizen videos of it and use those as well. I think it's just a question of what the language is going to be like and whether they can come up with something. But it sounds like if not, again, I think the sense of a lot of people is that it's likely something will go through, but it's probably going to be a lot better than what it is right now.
Yeah, sir.
I also want to ask about the drones because, you know, obviously it's a very impressive tool for the media.
Right.
And I really appreciate your desire to form a template that other states could follow. That would be great. But to that end, wouldn't it be more elegant to create a regulation that says what you can photograph as opposed to what you can't photograph?
Well, in fact, the statute does. And I think part of where it runs into problems is that it does try to do that. So it's got a list of things and people who can do drone use and what they can do it for. Like for fire suppression, for, you know, if there's a disaster, government's allowed to go in and use drones. But the problem is, you know, there are always things that are unexpected that come up. So what's the general standard that applies where the legislation doesn't really address it? And this legislation, currently the default is that you can't do it. The effort is to try and come up with a default or a more general exception for where something is of legitimate public interest, or where there isn't any reasonable expectation of privacy. You should be able to do it.
I mean, the point is that the photographers or the people who work for the media would know what they would know more easily what they can do.
Right.
Because it says right here. I mean, there is confusion even now as to the First Amendment when we photograph someone on the street. They say, you can't photograph me. But I explain, this is the First Amendment. We're on public property. So even something as simple as that is misunderstood. This is obviously a much more complex issue. And to approach it on that basis, what you can photograph at least gives everyone a simpler understanding of what you know, the law is.
Well, and this is actually worse than present law in the sense that this is a criminal prohibition. And it's got this prohibition about even possessing video that's in violation. So you mentioned possible criminal penalties to people, that makes them, you know, you don't want to be near the, you don't want to be in a gray area as much as you might otherwise.
And I guess my question is, how is that different, like, than the paparazzi, who, you know, go in with these big, huge zoom lenses and they get pictures of people and all of that, and they're protected?
Well, and that's part of what's going on here in this discussion of alternative language. The movie industry is, California has very extensive anti-paparazzi legislation against drones, and there's some people want to introduce all of that here. I don't know that Georgia really has a paparazzi problem like that. And I don't think the issue, part of what's driving the legislation though is people want to protect it's what you often hear with anything in the internet, that we want to try to keep, we want to protect people against that guy sitting in his pajamas with a drone who's out looking at the, you know, the neighbors. I mean, the fact is there are criminal prohibitions now that prevent that kind of eavesdropping.
Go ahead, sir.
Tom or Lori, do you think you sense that the First Amendment is under an even more dastardly or scurrilous attack? Does Donald Trump, for example, his assault on the news media, is that the tipping point of where we go?
I think there's sort of two challenges that are facing the First Amendment and news reporting generally right now. I think there's an ebb and flow in terms of respect for the media, and I do think we're at a point where there's a fair amount of hostility right now. But another part that I think is a very powerful influence that erodes First Amendment rights, particularly at the Georgia General Assembly, it kind of feeds into exactly what Peter's talking about, is very broad concerns right now about personal privacy. And one of the things we face over and over again in trying to monitor legislation at the General Assembly is erosion of the Open Records Act based on legislators basically trying to tap into the public's concern about their personal information, about that there is a great deal of public concern that their identity is going to be stolen, that their personal information is being used in ways they don't anticipate. A lot of that, frankly, takes place at the commercial level, not with government records. But legislators are increasingly adding exceptions to the Open Records Act to restrict access to government records that are really very helpful at revealing what government does on a daily basis, under the guise of saying, well, we're trying to protect personal privacy. We're trying to make sure the citizen's personal information is not lost. So very frequently, what will protect citizens' information is the routine part of Open Records Act, is where things get redacted. No government records are released intentionally in the state of Georgia that have private personal information about citizens. That information is redacted by the agencies before it's released. So we don't need to create new exceptions.
The Secretary of State's
office. Right. But over and over again, they're creating new exceptions for that situation. And Lori brings up a very good example of what occurred over the last, recently. There was a disclosure by the Secretary of State's office of database information that unfortunately did, where the personal information had not been redacted from us. Attorney General Owens is here, and he can explain the circumstances perhaps more, but as I understand it, the Secretary of State's office quickly recovered all copies of that information that was disclosed. In other words, all copies that had been released were quickly recovered by the Secretary of State, and so there really was no disclosure of personal privacy in that, of any personally private information in that situation. But it created quite a level of concern. And so that is something legislators respond to. So we're constantly fighting a battle to try and make sure access to public information is not lost based on fears about personal privacy.
And I'll just add, I kind of chuckled when I first heard it, but some of these college kids on college campuses who are saying they want to do away with the First Amendment, I laughed, of course, and then I thought, oh my gosh, like, they're serious. What are they teaching in these colleges? And, you know, why would kids even think about that? And, you know, what I want to say is, hey, have you ever reported in China? Have you ever been to Cuba? Go see how important the First Amendment is. So I think we need to do something at the college level, too, to really reiterate to kids that it's the First Amendment. It's first for a reason.
Well, I think we should go a little deeper to high school.
Yes.
Before they get to that.
Yes.
Other question, Nydia, go ahead.
Good morning, I'm Nydia Tisdale. What public notice is required to ban video recording in either a public or a private place?
Who wants to jump in?
No idea why you would want to know this. You, right?
I really am racking my brain to figure out why.
So, just broadly, in terms of banning videotaping in a private place, that is up to the owner of the private location. And so if it's not a public meeting, if it's not a meeting subject to the Open Meetings Act, then the owner of the private facility is going to have the discretion to permit or not permit videotaping. Public, any meeting that's subject to the Open Meetings Act is required, they are required to permit audio or videotaping. And so, as you know well, and Nydia's been involved in litigation, the Attorney General very successfully represented her in connection with that litigation. You are permitted to videotape in an open meeting subject to the Open Meetings Act, and excluding you is a violation of the Open Meetings Act, and in Ms. Tisdale's case resulted in fine and attorney's fees being entered against the city of Cumming in connection with that.
Geary, is there ever an argument, though, that maybe some private forums still can be open to the public, become matter places of public accommodation? Does that change it at all?
Yeah, and a lot of times, I mean, in Nydia's case in particular, some media outlets were allowed to film and others were not. There was no ban.
But in terms of notice, I don't know that the law requires any particular notice. It's not supposed to happen. They're not supposed to, if it's an open meeting ban.
I guess if it's advertised as an open to the public meeting and they select one individual and ban that person from video recording, what type of notice is required? It's sort of a hybrid situation.
It's also a pooling thing, like, right? Because in judicial
proceedings, it's very confusing.
They can do that and they have to share it. And so I don't know if there's any law specifically that relates to that.
For anybody who hadn't had a chance, anybody else before we go?
Yeah.
Hey, Art. Go ahead.
Made for tall people like Peter. I'm Art Harris, CBS 46 right now. I don't know if that works or not. But I'm wondering about the Shield Law for any of you all, as someone who tends to push the buttons of prosecutors. I've got one who has basically threatened to come and get my files, outtakes, things like that, because I interviewed a fugitive mother was on the run from an abusive husband he prosecuted, and he didn't like that. Right now, the U.S. Marshals hit homes of all her relatives and friends last week. And so I'm not sure how protected we are. Does the new legislation change anything in terms of the Shield Law? Should we feel intimidated? Are there preventive things that we can do? And what if you wind up on tape that they have obtained of wiretaps of these people you've interviewed, family, friends, can they use that in any way? Just sort of a free-floating question of how bulletproof are we?
Sure, I'll jump in on some of this. So you're in a pretty good position in the state of Georgia. And so let me explain what a Shield Law is and where we stand right now. What Art is referring to is laws have been passed in most of the American states, including Georgia, that protect reporters when subpoenas are issued for either their testimony or records. Georgia has a very effective Shield Law that applies basically in all of our state courts here. There's also a privilege recognized under the 11th Circuit. And what that means is a reporter does not have to testify in a case or provide records in response to a subpoena in a case in which they are not involved. So we're not talking about a defamation case against the news organization, but we're talking about a case between two other parties, and they want to try and use either a criminal civil case against other parties, and they want to try and use the reporter's information. And in that situation, in Georgia, there's a law that really, the effect of the law is that you can't use a reporter or a reporter's resources as a witness or evidence except in the most extraordinary circumstances. It has to be a situation where really the issue where it comes up and is at the creates the most friction is when a criminal defendant says, the only evidence I have that will protect me from a conviction is in the possession of a reporter. That's an extraordinarily rare circumstances. The vast more common situation is two civil litigants are trying to bring reporters' information into a case, or a prosecutor or a defense attorney is trying to use a reporter. So in Georgia, it's almost never the case that a reporter has to testify. There was some legislation dropped last year in the last legislative session that is still theoretically live in this legislative session that would have changed our shield law slightly. And I think that legislation was dropped with the intention of trying to strengthen our shield law. It actually would not have accomplished that purpose, but the legislation has not moved at all so far. And I don't anticipate it will pick up any steam in this session. And so I think the end result is, in this state, we have a good and effective shield law. And it seems now entrenched and unlikely to be altered by the Georgia General Assembly.
Yeah, I would go so far as to say that it's even in a criminal case, it's really only a grand jury case that I'd be terribly concerned. In a criminal case, if there is any alternative, and so they have construed that broadly, so if 30 people could be questioned in advance, then 30 people have to be questioned first. And if it turns out that, you know, they want it because you were the one directly that heard it, or you have video, or you've got something that's special, that's not good enough. If you can get somebody else who heard the conversation to testify to that same conversation, then they can't make the reporter go. But your question, I thought it was interesting, was what if you're being wiretapped and somehow or another they get that information? Well, the other time you could have to testify is to the extent it's waived. So generally we try to get people to authenticate that whatever's been broadcast, but whatever you've published has been waived. And what anybody has in the police department, I think, is also fair game for them to use. I've never ever been in a situation though where somebody was a reporter was wiretapped, so I don't know, but I assume they probably could use that, but they couldn't compel you to come testify because they've got video, they've got other ways to show that same information, if that makes sense. Is that, did you agree, Tom?
I do agree, and I do. I mean, one thing to be clear, your question is a good one, particularly with respect to right now when reporters are using their cell phones, reporters are using sending emails. There's a great deal of basically digital information that law enforcement is allowed to collect, and the privilege doesn't prevent them from collecting that information. So particularly in a wiretap situation, it is important that reporters be very careful how they are communicating with that person, because law enforcement can be listening and law enforcement can collect the history of a criminal defendant's cell phone, which is going to show their communications, them having an exchange of telephone calls with a reporter. And so there's ways law enforcement can see that information. Their ability to actually call a reporter as a witness is much more limited.
I wonder if they kind of
there have been cases in Georgia, for example, where reporters would be talking with jail inmates. The sheriffs would routinely record those conversations the jail inmates had over the phone. So, I mean, the reporter would be recorded on those, and that's not protected by any shield law.
My question is, can a prosecutor get a search warrant from a judge to wiretap fugitives, their friends, their distant family members, relatives, have no idea what's going on, and at the same time, you are on some of those tapes. I don't know if that's the case, but paid to be heroin. If the judge knew that this was going on, does he have any kind of a duty to, well, you can't, if these journalists is on the call, you can't wiretap them?
He doesn't have that duty, and a judge really would be very unlikely to interfere in that. In other words, if they have a valid wiretap, they're allowed to listen in to the conversations, and the judge, and there's no privilege that protects a reporter's conversations in that situation.
Let me say we are at 9, and I know there's probably tons of more questions. We are going to send you over to the right, my far right, your far left, to go for the tour. But thank you so much to these amazing, knowledgeable people. Thank you. Let us know if you hear of anything at the legislature that we need to follow up on so we can all monitor it together. Thank you.
And also March 4th and February 4th, they're going to have a committee meeting on the St. Slap Bill. At least it's
front.
Mr.
Mayor,
Yes, it is.